Welcome to Project Lukot HaSichas. We're going to be learning today Sicha Beis of Parshas Pekudei in Chelek Yud Aleph, page 175. B'tchilas Parshas Seinu, Eile Pekudei HaMishkan, Mishkan HaEdus V'Gomer, Maitek Rashi B'dibur HaMaschal HaSheni, Es HaTevois, HaMishkan, Mishkan. So Rashi brings from the Pasuk the two words, Mishkan, Mishkan, U'mefarish, and Rashi explains. Shnei pa'omim, the Torah says, ha-mishkan, mishkan twice, remez le-mikdash, shenismashkin b'shnei churbanin, ala v'nisayim shal Yisrael. This is a hint to the two batim mikdashos that were taken as a collateral, were taken as a mashkin when they were destroyed because of the sins of the Yidden. That's the repetition of mashkin, mashkin, or mishkan, mishkan, which refers to a mashkin, the fact that the two batim mikdashos were destroyed and taken as a collateral because of the sins of Yidden. B'tzarech lahavin, so we have the following questions that need to be explained in this Rashi. The Rebbe and all is going to ask over here seven questions. Aleph, hein emes, sha'in kishala atzmai. So now the very fact that this remez comes up right over here in Parshas Pekudei. Masha b'roish parshasenu yesh remez, lebeiz ha-mikdashos, humilse b'taima. This is the right place. It makes sense that this remez comes here. Since this parsha is sort of a sacha koil, it's the final calculation of all the details of everything that was done in building the Mishkan. As Rashi says in the beginning of this pasuk, in this parsha, it was counted all of the weights of the donations of the Mishkan. Or Mishkale actually means all of the coins that they brought for the Mishkan. Kesev, Lezav, Lechoshes, and Venimna Kolkela, Lecholavidasai, the silver, the gold, the copper, and all the other items that were brought. So Lechain, Kanu, Amokim, Lerames, Le'oibes, Mikdashes, Shi'ilasit. So here is the right place to also hint to the fact that besides the Mishkan that's being built at this time, there's also going to be two Batim Mikdashes in the future that the Yidden will have. Ulam Kashalahavn. However, what's difficult here is as follows. Lama ba remez bekosov beinyin hamayr al churbanan. Why is the remez in the pasuk, in the words mishkan, mishkan, that refers to the churban, the destruction of the two beis hamikdashes? Sha'am mikdash nismashkin b'shnei churbanan. That it was destroyed twice. V'loy b'remez acher. And why isn't the Torah hinting to the future Beis HaMikdash when it will be standing? Not when it will be destroyed. Adarab, we're talking here about the Sacha Kail of the building of the Mishkan, so we should also hint to the future of the building of the two Batim Mikdashes. Beis Yisayrim, he said the question goes even further. Lama Dorshu Razal Hatev Sanal Meloshen Mashkin. Why are Razal interpreting the Pasuk this way? There's actually an alternative way how to interpret this Pasuk here. Hamayr al chobana, that refers to the destruction. Va'arei bekame mekaymis, in many places, upshute shel mikra, in the simple pshat of the pasuk, hu lefarshay meloshen v'shachanti b'seicham. The word mishkan is the place where the shechinah dwells. That's what it means. V'shachanti. Shahoyah zegam b'mikdash. And this is true about the mikdash as well, that the Eibusha dwelled in the Beis HaMikdash. U'ba'ifin shayna b'echad ma'asheni. The level of shechinah that was in the first Beis HaMikdash is not the same to what was in the second Beis HaMikdash. So why wouldn't we say that when it says Mishkan, Mishkan, Shnei Pamim, it refers to two Batim Mikdashos where the Eibusha dwells in, not taken as a collateral, as a mashkin? Gimel, Mizesh, Rashi Maitik. HaMishkan, Mishkan. So Rashi brings from the Pasuk the repetition of HaMishkan, Mishkan. Muva Mielov, Shadi Yukehu, Me'achpalas, Tevis Mishkan. So it's self-understood what he's coming to address. The fact that there's a repetition here in this word. So why does Rashi have to spell this out clearly? Shnei pamim. That is, look, you see, it says it twice. Befrat sheberoiv amekaymis kekulam darke lefarish mebli lahakdem esakushia mesasheves bepirusha. Rashi gives his pshat in the pasuk without telling you what the question he's coming to answer with his pshat. So kolshkin benidin didan shadiyek shel shnei pamim baylatu. Most definitely right over here. The fact that it says twice is something that Rashi doesn't have to point out explicitly. It's very clear what Rashi is coming to address. Dalit, another question here is Lama Dayik Rashi Loimer Remez Lamikdosh Shenis Mashkin Loshin Yochid Vishnei Churbanen. Why does Rashi refer to two Bati Mikdoshais with a singular term that it's a Remez to one Mikdosh that was taken as a collateral? Va'alahim Beis Mikdoshis. If the repetition of twice Mishkan Mishkan refers to two Mikdoshis. The two mikdashes that were taken as a mashkin, hamasima gam yaisa hein letchilas dvarav shnei pamim, which fits better with the beginning of what Rashi starts with, shnei pamim, that is twice, vehela hemshach dvarav, and the conclusion of what he says, b'shnei churbanan, that this happens by two churbanan, lashon rabim, in a plural term. Hey, another question here is le'eze tam. Why does Rashi have to spell out and explain what the cause of the Churban is because of the Avedis of Eden? So Rashi's question is that it says Mishkan twice. So the answer to that is there and is explained. It's a hint to two Batim Mikdashos that will be taken as a Mashkin. The cause of why that's going to happen is irrelevant for the pshat of the pasuk here. Vav, another question is, ala pasuk earlier in Parshas Vayigash, Vayipoel al tzavrei binyamin achi vayevku binyamin bach al tzavorov, that Yosef falls on the neck of his brother Binyamin, and Binyamin falls on the neck of his brother Yosef. So what's the remez here? Pirish Rashi shekoy al shnei mikdashos, shasidin li es b'chelke shel Binyamin v'soifon licharev. There are two mikdashes that are going to be in the portion in Eretz Yisrael of Binyamin, and they're going to be destroyed. And there's a mikdash Mishkan Shiloi that will be in the portion of Yosef in Eretz Yisrael, and is also going to be destroyed. So they were crying also about the future. So what do we see here that Rashi already tells us before about this? Hare shegam Mishkan Shiloi nechrav kemoi beza mikdashes. So besides the two Batim Mikdashis that were destroyed, you also have Mishkan Shiloi that was destroyed. Okay, Yesh Lahakshayis. If so, we could ask the following question. Minale l'Rashi shekavonas ha-kosuf b'mash ha-kosuf ha-mishkan mishkan beis pomim l'chobonan shebeis ha-mikdashis. How does Rashi know to say that the repetition of Mishkan twice refers to the two Mikdashis? V'nishar b'tzarechiyin l'ma l'nirmas churbonay shal Mishkan Shiloi. And then we would remain with a question. So why is there no hint to the Churban of Mishkan Shiloh here? Ulai, perhaps, in Vadarabba, Yosef Karav Loimar, it would be more logical to say, Shekavanosai lechurbanan shal Mishkan Shiloh, hakaidim lahem, vishal mikdash rishain. Let's go back to what's before. Why not say that the repetition of Mishkan Mishkan refers to once the Mishkan Shiloh being destroyed, and also the first place of Mikdash? And then we wouldn't have a question regarding why the second Beis HaMikdash is not hinted here, as the Rebbe explains in parentheses. We would answer that the Churban of the second Beis HaMikdash is not mentioned, ki hoya chaser, because it was a Mikdash l'chatchila that was lacking in five areas. So it wasn't with the same intensity of the Shechina there. So therefore that's not included. Mashenke Mishkan de Moshe was Shnei Anal, which is not the case with the Shechina dwelling in the Mishkan of Moshe Rabbeinu, and the Mishkan Shiloi, and the first Beis HaMikdash, the dwelling of the Shechina there was more complete. And that's why that's hinted there, because they're compared in that sense. So we would understand why the second Beis HaMikdash is left out. So why does Rashi say that Mishkan Mishkan refers to the two Batim Mikdashais and not Mishkan Shiloi? Zayin, the seventh and final question on Rashi here is, Rashi Mefarish, May Haloshin Mishkan Shaham Mikdash Nismashkin Bishnei Churbanan. From the word Mishkan, we see that the Beis HaMikdash was taken as a Mashkin. Haino, meaning Shechurbanish Shalam Mikdash Shubayfin Adayim Elo Lekichas Mashkin. It could be compared to a lender taking a collateral. Now, if we look at what happened, it doesn't seem to be the case. Shereya Mashkin Hudova Nitlma Aloyve Boyfin Arayuzmani. A mashkin is what a lender will take from the borrower for temporarily until he has money to pay. And then he returns the very same object to its owner, to the borrower. Ulufiza, benidin didan over here in our case. Keshalaka HaKadosh Baruch Hu on Mikdash Rishon LaMashkin, the Eibush took away from the Yidden, he destroyed the first base of Mikdash and took it as a mashkin. If in fact it's a mashkin, it should be returned as is. The second Beis HaMikdash should be the very same building, the very same object returned to the Yidden. But Ubepayel, what's the reality? There were many things that were missing in the second Beis HaMikdash that were there in the first. Rashi already wrote this earlier. In Parashas Noyach, Yaft Elikim LeYefes. So Rashi there says, Afa Pisha Bona Kaidish Bayez Sheni. Kaidish built the second base of Mikdash, Le Sharsa by Shechina. The Shechina did not dwell there the way it did in the first. Vehechan Sharsa by Mikdash Risha. It dwelled in the first base of Mikdash. So we see that there was a major difference as far as the level of Shechina in the second base of Mikdash comparing to the first. Ube Parshas Tetzava Pirish Rashi. Ube Mikdash Sheni Hoya Achoyshin Chulu. In the second base of Mikdash, the Kain had the Choyshin. The name of Hashem that was inside the Choshen in the first Beis HaMikdash was not there in the second Beis HaMikdash. So we see that in the second Beis HaMikdash it was lacking. So how can we say that the first Beis HaMikdash is taken as a mashkin and is being returned as is? It wasn't returned, the very same level of Shechina and so on in the first Beis HaMikdash was not returned in the second Beis HaMikdash. So we have many, many questions on this seemingly short and simple Rashi over here that the Rebbe asks. We need to understand what's going on. Says the Rebbe, Vayta Vabir Bezeh. So the Pshat is as follows. Iker Inyan Beis HaMikdash. So the first thing the Rebbe will point out, if we're looking at the two Batei Mikdashes and we want to see if they're similar or not similar, one of the main points that Rebbe pointed out in the question is that they seem to not be similar. But if we take a look at what the essence of the Beis HaMikdash is, we'll discover that in essence they are the same. Ikir inyan Beis HaMikdash, ukamashikosav, the pasuk describes the Beis HaMikdash already much earlier in Parshas Vayetze, Beis Elokim, this is an abode for Hashem. Vizeh shara shamayim, this is the gateway to heaven. What does it mean, gateway to heaven? Beis HaMikdash shalamayla. In Hara Miria, the place where the Beis HaMikdash is, it's positioned opposite the Beis HaMikdash Shalamayla, a spiritual Beis HaMikdash above, and therefore this is the permanent dwelling of Hashem. Va'omer, there's another pasuk in Parshas Beshalach, Mochin l'shiftecha pa'alta Hashem. This is the seat, this is the place where Hashem sits, the Shechina is here in the Beis HaMikdash, and Rashi there says again that this is the permanent dwelling of Hashem because it's corresponding and opposite the Beis HaMikdash above. Another pasuk in Parshas Mishpatim, Hamokim Asher Hachi Noisi, the place which I have designated, the place of the Harabayis, Haramiria, which is corresponding to the Beis HaMikdash above. Ulechei Nema Boy, and therefore there's another pasuk where it says, which this is in Divrei Hayamim, Livnois as Beis Hashem Yerushalayim, the place to build the permanent dwelling, the home for Hashem is in Yerushalayim. V'nikra Beis Elamim, and it's also referred to as the Beis Elam, the everlasting home of Hashem. V'kol zeh hu b'shaveh b'shnei ha-batei ha-mikdash. This is the comparison, the main thing that characterizes the dwelling of Hashem is equal by the two batei mikdash. Masha'en ken ha-mishkan, or mishkan shila, which is not the case with the mishkan of Moshe Rabbeinu in the Midbar, and mishkan shila in Eretz Yisrael, shaloi hayu mechavanim keneged Beis ha-mikdash shalamayla. It's not the permanent dwelling, and it's not corresponding to the spiritual Beis ha-mikdash above. V'nikram oil. It's only referred to as a tent, oil mayit, diras are la shchina, a temporary dwelling for the shchina. V'harei ain't doing the klal diras are la diras kva. You can't at all compare a temporary dwelling to a permanent dwelling. So therefore, we see that the first Beis HaMikdash and the second Beis HaMikdash are in essence the same. The Mishkan and the Mishkan Shiloi are in a completely different category. This is simply understood even for a child of 5 years old. The details that made differentiate one home from another does not change the main essential character of a home. It's a permanent dwelling for the one that lives inside it. That's what the essence of what a home is about. Oil, which is not the case with a tent. Even if it contains in the different details, a design, furniture, or other things that are in a temporary dwelling that might be more compared to a house then another house is compared to this house. But Mekomakim Shainu B'Nekudasei HaYikris, in its very essence of what it is, it's a temporary dwelling, it's totally not compared to a permanent home. Shurak Diras Arab, Eloi Diras Kva. So therefore, even if it could be that as far as the details of the first Beis HaMikdash and the second Beis HaMikdash, or the level of Shechinah and other things, it wasn't the same, but as far as the essence and the nature of what the Beis HaMikdash is, the permanent dwelling for Hashem, they're the same. In that sense, they're equal. So Val Pizem move on. The Av She'ein Beis HaMikdash is Doim Ezel Ezel B'Kama V'Kama Pratim. But nevertheless, Mekiv V'Shenu Kudosam Ikris Achasi, with the main point, the essence of what it is, it's the same bias. L'shchinasi is barach, a home for Hashem. Harayasheni hu achzaras amashkin shalarishen. When the Eibishter gives back the Yidden, the second Beis HaMikdash, it is returning the same Beis HaMikdash as before. It's returning the dwelling, the permanent dwelling, the home of Hashem. Hashenkin ha-mishkan shaya oyal. The Mishkan, which was just a tent. Iyef shaloyma boy. You can't say regarding this tent, shen ismashkin, that it was taken as a mashkin, v'hochzar ha-mashkin be-beis ha-mikdash, and then this tent is returned to the Yidden in the Beis ha-mikdash. It's totally not the same. Mekivim she'enem doimim, v'nekudasam ikris. They're not compared to each other in the very essence of what it is. This is a temporary dwelling, and this is a home. So therefore, over here, when we're talking about the remez of a mashkin, it has to be referring only to the two batim mikdashos, and not to Mishkan Shiloi and the first Beis ha-mikdash. Another point that we could explain here, why Rashi chooses the two batim mikdash and not Mishkan Shiloh in the Beis HaMikdash. Haremez lebeis hamashkainis, hu hamishkan hamishkan beis pamim. Where is the remez? Where is the hint for these two mashkainis? Mishkan, mishkan, it's the two repetition of this word, mishkan, mishkan. Hainu shtei teves hadoim ezel ezel, the same word repeated. The fact that there's a hint to two places where the Shekhinah dwelled in two words that are the same words repeated again, so that teaches us what it's hinting to. Shagam heim shavim zelazet, that it's hinting to two things that are equal, that are the same. So if so, the hint is to the two permanent dwellings, the two Bate Mikdash, that are the same, as the Rebbe explained before. And not to an oil, a temporary dwelling, and a house, a home, the Beis HaMikdash. So in the very remez of HaMishkan Mishkan, twice repeating the same words, we see that it refers to the same place, the same kind of place, a Beis HaMikdash, the two Bate Mikdash, and not to the oil Shiloh in the Beis HaMikdash. So now we can understand what Rashi means. Rashi adds and emphasizes that the Torah is repeating the same word twice, although it's self-understood that that's what he's coming to address. The Bezeo Madgish, what Rashi is emphasizing here is that this is not only a hint, because there's an extra word here. There's a repetition, an extra word. If that was the case, then it doesn't force us to say that the two things, the two batei mikdash that it's hinting to, are compared to each other. Ella, rather, what Rashi is saying is shahalimud hu mizeh shem mishkan miloshen mashkin nema shnei pomen. The hint over here is that the very same word is repeated twice. Oisaya inyan nema pamayim. It's the very same word and concept that the Torah repeats twice. And it's this repetition that tells us that this one mikdash is there by the first base of mikdash and comes back by the second base of mikdash. It's not really a different base of mikdash. It's the very same mikdash that was there the first time and was taken as a mashkin and is coming back. That's why it says it's the same word, because it's the same thing that's coming back. Kalaymar hu amikdash arishayim v'hu amikdash hasheni. If the first Beis HaMikdash is the second Beis HaMikdash, Mikdash Echad, it's the same Beis HaMikdash that's coming back. But then it's taken as a mashkin in between, and also after the Churban of the second Beis HaMikdash, it's taken as a mashkin until the Eibishter will rebuild the third Beis HaMikdash. So if so, it's obvious, She'en HaMaduba B'Mishkan Shiloi U'Beis HaMikdash. So therefore, it doesn't refer to Mishkan Shiloi and the Beis HaMikdash, which are not compared to each other, B'chlal. So this explains why Rashi over here uses the singular term that it's a remez lemikdash and ismashkin, and not remez to two bate mikdash, which one is mashkin, because the whole point here is that it's the same word being repeated twice, because in essence they are one and the same. It's the same Mikdash that comes back by the second Beis HaMikdash. That's the pshat over here, that it's Lashon Yochid and Rashi. Vav ha'pikein, kaysev Rashi, remez l'mikdash. Now the Rebbe Bavonin is another shaila, based on what we're saying here, that the similarity of the two batei mikdash, as opposed to the Mishkan Shiloh, is the fact that they're both a bayis, they're a permanent dwelling. Why wouldn't Rashi spell that out clearly in his words? Why wouldn't Rashi say beis hamikdash? Rashi writes mikdash v'loy beis hamikdash kanal, if that's an important point there, but Rashi still skips it. Ki kedarkai, as Rashi's derech is, shafila agadosh v'pirushai, tzarech liyis miyashev es divrei hamikra. Even when Rashi brings a remez, a drash, in his pshat, but it still has to fit into the wording of a pasuk. Ubalashna mikra matzinu mishkan u'mikdash, the hainu hach. In the language of the Torah, we find mishkan and mikdash, which are the same thing, a place where the Shechina dwells. Mashenkein beis hamikdash. The expression of beis hamikdash we don't find in the pasuk. So therefore, Rashi is using the terminology of the Torah in order to apply his pshat fitting into the lashon of the pasuk. The Rebbe continues, v'alpizeh, shoha ikir, bekavonis haremez, u'inyin ha-mashkin. Now that we see that the whole point of here is the mashkin, and the point of the mashkin is that it's the same Beis HaMikdash that was there the first time and comes back by the second Beis HaMikdash. That's the concept of a mashkin, that it's returning the very same thing. Yuvan atam, lo meremez ha-kosov, le-Beis HaMikdash, as kifi shehem mashkin, shu'inyin ha-churban. Why the Torah is being meramas to the two batei mikdashos in this concept of a mashkin, which is referring to the fact that there's going to be a churban. Taking it as a mashkin is the churban. The adarabba, on the contrary, mashkin madgishu mechadish, the whole chiddush of the mashkin is shehadava nimtza b'shleimusay tamada afilu kishavim b'reshus l'reshus. The whole idea of a mashkin is, even when the borrower gives this item to the lender, it's there. It's fully intact. It's being safeguarded by the lender until he'll pay him the money. It's not being destroyed. It's not being annulled and taken away completely. It's there fully. So adarabba, it's emphasizing not only do you have these two batei mikdash, but it's really one Beis HaMikdash that's just going from where it is here below, and when it's destroyed, Eibush is sort of possessing it and safeguarding it in order to return the very same Beis HaMikdash again. That's the chiddush over here. So therefore, Rashi doesn't say Mishkan means, like we usually touch, Mishkan is the dwelling. Mishkan refers to this concept of mashkin. That's the whole chiddush over here. That we're talking about the very same mishkan that's there and only taken as a mashkin and being returned again. The two batei mikdash are one and the same. That's the chiddush here. Churban beis hamikdash lehoy bayit mishakadosh baruch hu bitul hametzias chas v'shalom. It wasn't that Hashem completely took away the whole concept of the beis hamikdash by the destruction of the first, and then by the second Beis HaMikdash, it's a brand new Beis HaMikdash that's being rebuilt and being given to the Yidden. That's not what happens. Kiyim rather, actually, lokech es HaMikdash b'tur mashkin. The Eibush is taking it, the Eibush is possessing it, and safeguarding it like a collateral. Va'achakach echziroi, and by the second Beis HaMikdash, the Eibush returned it. And va'asad la'achziroi, and the Eibush will in the future return it to the third Beis HaMikdash, l'bnei Yisrael, to Yidden. So that's the whole concept over here. That's the remez, the beautiful idea that comes out from this mashkin. That it's a repetition of the two words that are the same word that shows that it's really one and the same, and there's never a real concept of churban that takes place. The churban is just Hashem possessing it with the intention to return it when it'll be possible. Vasi shaper. So now we can understand. Masha Rashi misayin b'pirushoi alav enisayim shol Yisrael. That the mashkin is being taken because of the sins of Yidden. This is the basis and the explanation of why it's only a mashkin and not a real destruction. If it was the case that the Beis HaMikdash was destroyed for its own reason, not because of whatever Yidden did that caused it, but the Beis HaMikdash itself has to be destroyed at a certain point. For example, the Rebbe says, "Sheigia seif zman ki yumai shehuk v'lo b'tchila v'chayetze b'za." If we would say that the Beis HaMikdash has a certain expiration date, this is how long it's going to be standing, and after that, it's destroyed. Harei ze bitl. So then when it's destroyed, it's a real destruction. It's gone. It's removed. And then the Yidden have to earn a new Beis HaMikdash from scratch. But, abo me'achad ha'sib hi ha'v'nisein shel Yisrael. It's only the Yidden that bring about this destruction. Hainu shanhagis b'nei Yisrael gam. It's an external thing that the Yidden's avedus is what causes this, but the Mikdash doesn't have a built-in expiration date. So the definition of Churban is the access to the Yidden is being taken away. The Eibush is just possessing it and holding it, safeguarding it, until the time will come to return it. But it's not a real destruction. It's not completely taking away the Beis HaMikdash, that it's not there anymore. No, it's there, and it's just that the access to the Yidden has been removed. So this is the whole reason, this is the whole pshat of why it's Taka Amashkin. That's what Rashi brings up, of Inisayim Shal Yisrael. Oy tam, the Rebbe says, by Yisafuzov, Inisayim Shal Yisrael, Shabbipirish Rashi. We can give another reason why Rashi adds this detail of what caused the destruction, the sins of the Yidden. Letaretz, Rashi is answering the following question. Hey Nemes, yes it's true, Shaloshin HaKosev Mochach, the Eidi, Bebeza Mikdoshes Veloy Bishilai. That we're talking over here about the two mikdashes and not Shilei Kanal, as we've explained. Mekamokim zatz mitzorach bir. This needs an additional explanation. Lama leidama zakosov gam chor mishilei. Why did the Torah not hint to the fact that the Yidden will have another place, Mishkan Shilei, or chor mishilei? Or mevay Rashi. So therefore Rashi says al avinisayim shel Yisrael. That here the Torah is only referring to a mashkin, to the chorbin and the mashkin that was taken, in a case when it was the sins of the Yidden that caused it. Shekan merameses ha-teira le-mikdash and ish-mashkin b'bnei Yisrael, v'hainu ba'ad av-enisayim shal klal Yisrael. This is a mashkin that's been taken as a mashkin for all Yidden. When all Yidden will pay up their dues because of the averis that they did. That's what the remez over here is, something that relates to all of klal Yisrael. Mashenke mishkin shile shenechrav b'chetam shal chofni u'pinchas b'nei eili kemesupe b'navi. Mishkin shile was not destroyed because of all of the Yidden. And there was only the cause of the children of Eli that acted inappropriately, so that's why it was destroyed. So that's something that's related to individuals. It's not something that relates to all of klal Yisrael. And the Torah here is only bringing up the concept of a mashkin as it relates to all of klal Yisrael. Oid Yeshleima, the Rebbe says, we can go further and say another reason, a third reason, remez, another hint, by Sofas Rashi Venesem Shal Yisrael. In the fact that Rashi adds that the destruction and the mashkin is the only caused by the avedis of Yidden. Laharis, this comes to show, toikiv ki yumei shel hamikdash mitzad HaKadosh Baruch Hu, to what extent and how far and the standing of the Beis HaMikdash is from the Eibusher's perspective. Hainu goydel chefzai ritzayni Yisbarach, the great desire and will of Hashem, she yiskayim hamikdash b'teich bnei Yisrael, that the Beis HaMikdash should remain there, accessible to Yidden, amongst Yidden. Ki af opisha avenis bnei Yisrael hema goyrem l'chobim Beis HaMikdash. So Rashi is telling us it's the Avedis of Yidden that caused the Churban. But what's the history? It was already many years before the actual Churban that the Yidden were sinning. There were many sins that the Yidden transgressed. The same is true in the second Beis HaMikdash as the history is told in the Gemara and the Midrashim and in other places. Because then, nevertheless, Chika Kadosh Baruch Hu Zman Rav, the Eibishtu waited a long period of time. And the Beis HaMikdash wasn't actually destroyed, both regarding the first and the second Beis HaMikdash, until many years passed. Herech HaKadosh Baruch Hu Kiyim Beis HaMikdash Shonim Rabbis. The Eibishter extended the Beis HaMikdash is standing many years b'chdeshi Yeshuvu Bnei Yisrael Mavinisayim, to give the Yidden the opportunity to do tshuva. V'yishara Beis HaMikdash b'binyane, and perhaps the Beis HaMikdash then after the tshuva, so the Beis HaMikdash will stand. So this is the idea of Avinisayim Shal Yisrael, that it's the Avedis of Yidden, and then you look into the history, you see that the Eibishter extended this and gave the Yidden another chance to do tshuva. This follows the point that we said before, where basically, based on this sikha here, we see a different approach, a much deeper understanding of what the Churban is about. Kavanas akosav kan l'ramez al beis hamikdash ha'asidim liyes b'bnei Yisrael. The pasuk here is hinting to us, when we're talking here about the building of the Mishkan, it's hinting about the future batei mikdash that the Yidden will have, the first, second, and third. So the pasuk here is also hinting the extent of how powerful these batei mikdash are. Shagam beis churbanon, even while they're destroyed, einon ela bepchinas mashkin. It's not really destroyed. It's just possessed like a mashkin, but it's there. V'gam zois loy mitzad ha-mikdosh. There's no expiration date in the mikdosh itself. Kiyim b'vinisayim shal Yisrael. It's the cause of the Avedis of Yidden that doesn't allow them access to the Beis HaMikdash, but really the Beis HaMikdash is fully there. And v'lo yoyid, and it goes even further, ala shekol zeh ba'ifin shal yirotz HaKadosh Baruch Hu la'achrivay. If it's the sins that caused it, it should have been destroyed much earlier. The Yidden began sinning much before it was actually destroyed. So we see that the Eibishter waited, and he waited because the Beis HaMikdash is something that's very important, that it should be there amongst the Yidden. So all of this shows us how powerful the dwelling of the Shechina and the Beis HaMikdash amongst Yidden is. The lesson that we can take from this in a person's Aveda. The Gemara says this expression, it's enough for a servant to be as good as his master. And so we apply certain things that we see by the Eibishter that a Yid could learn from this how he should conduct himself. Just as the Eibishter held back from destroying the Beis HaMikdash a long period of time. Although the cause and the reason to destroy was there already for many years. Extending this time, the Eibush is empowering Eden, giving them the opportunity to do tshuva. So the same is true regarding our behavior. This is how we should behave with our, with another Yid, with our fellow. Not to ever withhold an extending hand to assist another Yid in matters of Torah and mitzvahs. Lazalei basiyas v'kiyam ha-mishkan, to assist him, to help him in building the mishkan, v'shachanti b'saycham, hashroas ha-shechina b'toich kolechat v'achat m'nei Yisrael, helping a Yid build and bring the dwelling of the Shechina within every single Yid. Afapi shanhoga zulosoi enikid abai. Although the conduct of this individual that you're extending a hand to him is not appropriate or is not proper, and he may not even deserve this help. You may say, oh, he's a sinner, why should I pay attention to him? But that's not the case. We have to follow the Eibishter's example of extending the time and giving the Yidden another opportunity to do tshuva, even though they sinned and they didn't deserve it. V'adarabe. On the contrary, nobody could say I'm exempt from this. This is a clear mitzvah, to rebuke your friend, in other words, to assist him, to show him, to teach him how to serve Hashem. Love your fellow as yourself. If you would be in that situation, wouldn't you want someone else to extend a hand and to assist you and help you to go back and to do what you're supposed to do tshuva? There's another very powerful point that we can see and learn from the Eibishter's conduct. Regarding extending a hand to help your friend in matters of Torah and mitzvahs, raya nesefes. We can bring another raya, another proof, kaviyachol, so to speak, man hagas hakadosh baruch hu atzmai, from the Eibishter's own conduct. Do not pay attention to the fact that your friend's conduct is not deserving for you to help him. You should anyways go out and help him. Where do we see this? So the Rebbe brings a very powerful lesson. The Parshas Tisa Mesuper Vayiten El Moshe Kechaloisei Ledaber Itoi Bahar Sinai Shnei Luchas Ehidus Gaimer. Moshe Rabbeinu after Matan Torah goes up to Har Sinai for 40 days and 40 nights. And at the conclusion of that time period, the Eibishter gives him the Luchas. Haynu shekeshegomar HaKadosh Baruch Hu ledaber itoy hachukim vaMishpatim miyad nasan le'aluchos. He gave him this luchos. So when was this? Zayse meres should be yomar ba'im laliyasai, on the 40th day laHar Sinai, when he went up to Har Sinai, see him HaKadosh Baruch Hu limudei Moshe. The Eibishter completes learning with him. Ubayse shah, and then nasan le'aluchos amanas detam l'bnei Yisrael. The Eibishter gives him the luchos to give to the Yidden. So that's what happens. Now, what happened the day before the 40th day? The Gamavor. Now the Pasuk tells us clearly, Shibnei Yisrael, Osu Esa Egel, B'yoyim Alamates, La'aliyas Moshe Har Sinai. The day before, on the 39th day of Moshe Rabbeinu being on Har Sinai, that's when the Yidden made the Egel. And the Eibishter was, of course, aware of this. Nimtza, so we have an amazing lesson here. Shigam La'achash Osu Esa Egel. After the Yidden already had made the Egel. Adayin, Loma Kadosh Baruch Hu Esa Teire Moshe. The Eibishter didn't stop right there. The Eibishter continued learning with Moshe. Amanas alam da'achak l'bnei Yisrael. And the purpose, of course, is to teach the Yidden. These Yidden that are making the Egel right now. And the Abish gives Moshe Rabbeinu then the Luchais to give to the Yidden. Af Shabbos Shah also is Egel. Although at that time, the Yidden had already served the Egel. So we see over here how the Abishter continues to teach Torah, to give Torah to Moshe Rabbeinu, to share with Yidden, even after the Yidden sinned to such a degree. Okay, and Alachas Kama Vekama. So most definitely, Shekain Tzorech Lies and Hogasa Adam. This should also be the behavior of every person. Not to hold back from influencing your friends in matters of Torah and mitzvahs. And don't take into account the fact that he seems like he's undeserving and he's unwilling and it's. Don't take any of that into account. Go and influence every single yid. The other rabbi. You'll go and do this, you'll follow the Eibishter's example, so then you'll cause an elevation, a spiritual elevation to your friend, to yourself. We were promised, when you influence, you help another, so then it illuminates the eyes of both. The person that's being helped and the person himself that's influencing will also become illuminated, he'll be elevated himself. We will merit to have the building of the Mikdash within the heart of every single Yid. And then also, to have the Beis HaMikdash built in its place, in its permanent place, in Har HaBayis, al Yidei Mashiach Tzidkenu, b'meheira v'yameinu, Amen.